Good afternoon, everyone. I am Nozizwe Dube, and I am a student here at the University of Leuven. I study law, and I am also the current coordinator of UNDIVIDED for KU Leuven. So thank you for being here. I would also like to thank the university for giving us the opportunity to hold our speakers' corner here today. So I'll start with a short introduction of UNDIVIDED and what UNDIVIDED exactly is. So UNDIVIDED is a student-led initiative that seeks to promote an inclusive culture within the entire university. And we do this with a clear conviction that educational settings are supposed to be inherently inclusive so as to ensure a beneficial learning environment for all actors within the university. So this includes professors, researchers, students, and all other personnel within the university structures. The main goal of UNDIVIDED is to make the university more inclusive through the three main domains the university works on, so namely education, research, and public service. We want to influence policy regarding diversity as well, so through participating in decision-making councils and by raising our voices in these spaces, we want to influence policy in a constructive manner. So we do this with students and staff members within the university. So through the expertise and research that is within the university and with the energy and the willing of like-minded students, we seek to cooperate and fulfill each other in all the possible ways. We want to learn from each other as well. So we believe that being an intersectional space where people can meet, listen, and learn from each other is an important asset of creating an open and diverse university. So to give you a clearer notion of UNDIVIDED, we exist for just over a year now. And the last few months, we have been working on the topics such as LGBTQ+ students, gender, and decolonization of academia. We organized awareness campaigns on LGBTQ+ students the last few months, and with all our activities climaxing in a Pride Week. And for the topic decolonization of academia, we held a workshop given by Ms. Stella Nyanchima from the organization Hand in Hand Against Racism. And we also organized a guest lecture on decolonization of academia that was given by human rights expert Professor Sylvia Tamale from Makerere University in Uganda. And we also screened interesting and thought-provoking documentaries and movies, eventually accompanied by Q&As or debates afterwards. So today, to get to the topic of today, I will be talking about decolonization of academia. And since we decided to focus on this topic, I have seen many puzzled faces on the faces of students, professors, researchers, and the like. You can almost see everyone questioning. We had decolonization in the 20th century already, where there was flag independence for many countries in Africa and in Asia. So why do you still have to decolonize? So yes, it is true that flag independence happened widely during the 20th century, but what is so widely forgotten and overlooked is that in order for colonization to happen, there had to be a platform set out to deem the whole project possible. So ideologies such as white supremacy and imperialism did not just sprout out of nowhere. Chattel slavery and colonialism didn't just occur overnight. So these phenomenons all have roots in several fields that are also studied extensively in universities. And these ideologies and ideas are rarely questioned in the books that are present in our university libraries, and other voices that oppose the status quo don't seem to find their way into the books that we read in this university. So many university curricula present Western knowledge as universal knowledge, when there are seven continents on the planet with very vast cultures and peoples that all influence the world as we know it today. This realization brings us to the premise that the decolonization of academia is a quest that still actually needs to be ventured on. And no, decolonization of academia is not about burning books in libraries, as some have wrongly interpreted the whole topic to be about that. So I shall give a few examples, and they are not exhaustive, of what we mean when we say decolonize academia or decolonize curricula. So during my secondary school studies in Belgium, I focused majorly in mathematics and sciences, exact sciences to be more precise, and biology was among one of my very favorite subjects as a young student. And one of the characteristics that drew my interest to exact sciences was the neutrality in which they were presented to me by my teachers, documentaries, and books that we were assigned to read. But upon further personal reading than the above assigned reading and documentary watching that I did, I came to the realization that sciences have also been weaponized and skewed to be everything but neutral in some circumstances. So throughout history, science has often been used as a justification to propose, to project, and to enact racist social policies everywhere in the world. So let's start with biology and its role in scientific racism. So Charles Darwin used his evolution theory to justify white supremacy and violent imperialism in his 1859 book, The Origin of Species. And this book also has a subtitle, as you can see in the presentation, Preservation of Favored Races in the Struggle for Life. In his later book, The Descent of Man, Darwin repeatedly refers to non-white and non-European people as, and I quote, savages, and writes that the extermination of non-white races is a natural consequence of white Europeans being a superior and more successful race. He goes further to write that white people are further evolved, and he says, and I quote, Western nations of Europe now so immeasurably surpass their former savage progenitors and stand at the summit of civilization. Now, am I saying that Darwin's evolution theory should be thrown in the dustbin altogether? Absolutely not. I'm not going to fall into the whole trap of, you know, poisoning the well. That's a logical argument that many people, a logical mistake that many people tend to make. So for me, Darwin's evolution theory is still standing, still respected. But my critique in this is that this view of Darwin is rarely portrayed to students who study these respective fields so as to show to them how scientific knowledge used with a completely different purpose can lead to disastrous evolutions. So similar rhetoric can also be found in other fields that are also studied within universities all over the world. And our next stop is the Faculty of Philosophy. And there we see renowned philosophers such as Kant, you can see here on the presentation, and Hegel, who portray what has since been labeled as philosophical racism. And you can see a few examples on the presentation as well. So all students in the university learn philosophy, including myself, and yet this side of these renowned and well-respected philosophers is never actually revealed to us, at least not to me. So furthermore, these philosophers are also presented as some of the only fundamental philosophers that shape the world, even in my own curriculum I studied in my first year at this university. I've always found this to be really interesting, as philosophies such as the Ubuntu philosophy have also formed the world in a significant way, but they're not widely explored in the books that are within the libraries of this university. So I remember a quote of late philosopher Sophie Oluwole popping up in my mind after taking a few philosophy classes. She said that she had studied philosophy at the University of Lagos in Nigeria, and the universities there were taking over the Western curricula, and she therefore studied the same philosophers that I just mentioned here. And she felt that she was a student at the University of London, but only just attending lessons in an African country. So later, when she wanted to specialize in African philosophy, she was told simply that African philosophers actually don't exist. And that she found that to be very strange, because in essence, philosophy means to think, and that is a human trait. So to claim that Africa did not have philosophers is to claim that Africans are therefore not human, which is very, very strange. So now, in order to colonize, the law has to be utilized as well to set up laws in which to effectively operate. An example is the apartheid regime, which had extensive laws to uphold white supremacy, which were written and solidified by legal scholars. Law, as I have learned over time, is everything but neutral. So legality does not equate something being inherently ethical, as I have also learned. So you see, the university, and specifically ones in Europe and Northern America, have played a massive role in creating the world as it is solidified today, in books and archives all over the world. But this perspective is rarely questioned by universities themselves, and students are not really given the chance to learn of these views and critically reflect on them so as to understand how knowledge that is produced and reproduced within this university is a weapon that can be used to further society or to oppress other people, and that this power lies within the hands of all who are able to gather knowledge within these institutions. So this brings us to the role of research and curricula. There needs to be more retrospection from researchers, and more specifically professors, in their role as people who make the decisions on what is studied, and most importantly, what is left out of our books. As people who have an influence on our education is put in our main obligatory classes that every student has to take, and which education is left out for the electives that students can choose to take, decolonizing academia is about questioning oneself what is deemed relevant education and what isn't. But more importantly, How is that chosen relevant knowledge? How has it formed the world as we know it today? And also how it is very Eurocentric. So it is not a sole task for the researchers themselves. It is also a question for the university as a whole. Is it willing to fund extensive research that gives space to explore these narratives? And is it a space where the people who will be dwelling on this research can perform their work with the same freedom as all other researchers? And is it willing to literally make space in its libraries to accommodate books that explore this other narrative? Is the work of African, Asian, and other indigenous scholars being respected and being given the same weight as European scholars in academic publications? Or is their work only deemed important and relevant when it is accompanied by European scholars or scholars from the United States of America? Because the absence of black and brown scholars in academia finds its roots in academic gatekeeping, whereby the expertise of black and brown scholars is systemically undervalued. So why is it seen as neutral when white people can do extensive research on white, black, and brown communities, but somehow when black and brown scholars do their own research on their own communities or on white people, it is usually deemed biased and not worthy of academic reverence? So this debate is a global one, with its roots in brave South African students that were rightfully questioning university's role in society today and in the past as well. So it spread to different universities such as Oxford and Cambridge, and we're here today talking about it. So decolonization is not a synonym of diversity. It is true, though, that successful and thorough decolonization will ultimately lead to inclusion and diversity within academia. Decolonization is structural work, so it is about questioning and critiquing institutions and practices. It is not about adding one or two footnotes of scholars such as Akil Mbembe or Mogubero Sasa in a philosophy book that is still otherwise not genuinely dissecting the importance, but also the dangerous rhetoric of Enlightenment-era scholars, for example. How, for example, Enlightenment-era scholars did do groundbreaking work to further a good cause for most of the people who found themselves on this continent at the time. But at the same time, their very uncritiqued ideals of people who were not white and European, and not European, laid out the foundation for imperialism, among many other things. So it is meticulous work that needs to happen specifically for each field. And I only dwell on a few specific fields here, but best believe that there's work for each and every single field of education, including the medical field, pharmaceutical field, and we can go on. So it is about the university taking a look back and dissecting its role in creating the world as we know it today. And yes, it will be uncomfortable, as it should be. So this work needs to start from those who have the means and the tools to do so. And I am sure some of you here may have the means to do that. I most definitely do not have all that it requires, and I'm not present in the boardrooms when the important meetings are taking place that determine all of these things, such as what is going to be in our curricula and what isn't. But I know maybe someone here may be, or may be listening. So I hope that one way or another, this message does reach that room where those important and critical decisions are being made. Thank you.